Okay, I'm going to talk about the flipped class experiment that I conducted in my class some time ago. So for example, these are the, I'm in fact teaching this class, this semester's undergraduate class, process control, using flip method. And every week I conduct a test. Okay, today's test, so here it is. Again, this is a low end kind of a thing. Okay, these are answers. So how many of you use LaTeX here? Anybody uses LaTeX? Okay, not many people. So it turns out that, of course, I'm a LaTeX fan. I even created spoken tutorials on LaTeX. And we have trained 1 lakh people using LaTeX across the country, even though LaTeX is very, you know, niche. Very sophisticated, not many people, you know, kind of, you see it as something difficult. What I wanted to show was, there are many nice things. You see this, I have question and answers. For each question, whatever that question is, don't worry about the question. For every question, there is an answer, right? So in LaTeX, I have defined a command called eat answer. So when I say, right now I have commented it, if I uncomment it and compile it, then all answers have disappeared. All answers have disappeared. So this is what I give it to my students. When I conduct an exam, I don't want to give a question paper with answers. Okay? I hide them, give it to them. So basically what I do is, I keep the question and answer together in the same place. See here? So look at the first one. Whatever it says, here is the question. Because of this big problem, we use digital to analog converters. Real-time systems cannot work with binary numbers, whatever. Here is the question, and I've given the answer. Answer is B. So it allows me to keep question and answer together, which is very nice, because otherwise we keep one question paper, answers are somewhere else, right? And then students found a mistake in our question, we modified it, but which one did we modify? Did we modify the one so that if we didn't modify the one that we gave it to the students, next year we may make the same mistake. So here the idea is to keep only one version. This is of course not true only for multiple choice questions. Let me show you. So here is a big quiz that I conducted. So it says, you know, for example, draw the root locus. And the answer goes several pages. It goes there, it continues. Figures are there, and this is where it ends. So it is not that it has to be with only multiple choice. Even long answers, so which is very useful because all of you will be creating a lot of questions during your tenure, and questions, answers, keep them all in one place, and then have only one version, keep improving it, okay, keep using the same thing in your class, and then there you are, okay? So anyway, this, because that page was already open, I thought I will talk about LaTeX, but I was not going to. I was going to show you the flipped classroom, right? By the way, I conducted a what is known as spoken tutorial based LaTeX workshop. How many of you are aware of spoken tutorials? Okay, good, a lot of people. If your institution uses spoken tutorials to train your students, raise your hand. Because you may be aware, but you may not be using it. Okay, very happy to know that. In fact, we circulated day before yesterday, I conducted a workshop for our research scholars. Free workshop, LaTeX, 2 hours. I said 2 hours you can learn what LaTeX, okay? About 300 people signed up because it's free, okay? I said that normally one third of the people come, so I expected 100 people. It turned out 150 people came, okay? And our workshops are called Massive self-learning, because spoken tutorial means you learn by yourself, massive self-learning, silent workshop. Even though there are 150 people, there are no question and answers, because they are learning through their video, they are posting their questions on the forum, they say that I have a question in this video at this time, 3 minutes, 45 seconds, I have a question. I go and answer. Then every other student who has the same question can go and see it there. So a few people can actually answer the questions of 150 people. Anyway, today there is going to be an interactive session. I'll be going right after that. That starts at 6 o'clock. But let me just see, show you the flipped classroom paper. So I have been using flipped method for now maybe 7 or 8 years. Initially, I started with my postgraduate control course, digital control, because class sizes are smaller and they are more mature. You can try out experiments. After a few years, we thought it was okay. So let me just tell you what is in it, because flipped method is very well known. On what basis, you know, we wrote a paper. What is new in it? This is what people ask. So we found that although flipped method is very good, what is flipped method? You give the videos or instructional material. It could be videos, it could be a book, it could be a website, it could be anything. And you say, come prepared. Whatever learning has to happen in the classroom happens outside the classroom. And you come to the class only for discussion, only for asking questions, only for, you know, removing your queries, doubts, you know, you have some extra question, and so on and so forth. Only for that, you come to the class. Okay? In other words, learning happens outside. Normally what happens is, you teach, students learn, they go home, they think about it, they have questions, and they ask later. Here it's the other way around. Learning happens outside, they come to the classroom and ask questions, and you answer them. So the whole thing is flipped. So it is called the flipped method. Right? Instead of learning happening in the classroom, it happens outside. Instead of questions coming outside, it is coming in the classroom. Discussion happens in the classroom, right? So this method has been shown to be reasonably effective. Many people, if you do flip method, you will get a lot of hits that say that it is a great method, greatest method possible, so on and so forth. But I found when I switched from digital control, that is my postgraduate class, to the undergraduate class, I found that the method actually failed. Method didn't work. Why the method didn't work was, students came to the class without going through the videos that they were supposed to go through. Okay? And their complaint was, look, why should I do double the work? For every lecture, you want me to go through the video and also ask me to come to the class, because double the work. Whereas for other classes, I'm spending only 1 hour. Because our students don't study 1 hour. For every classroom, 1 hour studies. That doesn't happen. Here, of course, we expect much more. After the flip, then you go ask them, okay, now do more work, more problems. So it is actually a lot more. And in fact, I did a literature review and found that it was indeed the problem. There were actually some review papers that criticized the flip method. It's not that everybody says flip method are the greatest. There are quite a few papers that actually said flip methods don't work. And the faculty members often have the tendency to give very large amount of reading assignment. Okay, give a lot of things, give a video, it can never be finished in 1 hour. You could not have finished it. But then you say it's a video, go and listen to it. And come and ask questions. That means you have covered the fourth portion. Okay? So this was given as a criticism. And in fact, there was a review paper. So one of the things that I figured out was, that whatever, by the way, this, let me show you. So here is the abstract. Okay, this is what I'm saying. The advantages of this method are well documented. See this for details, right? Although most people agree with the efficacy of the flip method, there is no guarantee that it is liked by everyone. While comparing different methods of teaching to the nursing students, so these students turned out to be nursing students in Texas A&M, and they found that the flipped classroom method was the least satisfactory in students' perception, least satisfactory. Because although it helped them get the highest examination score, the higher quantum of work was cited as the main reason for the lack of satisfaction in the approach. I got a lot of marks, but I'm still unhappy because you made me do too much work. Okay? And that was the reason why this was failing in IIT. So I told them, so it was important to convey the method. So the flipped method, if you see, MOOCs is a generalization of the flipped method because people learn on their own, at their own speed, and they can listen to it as many times as they want. They can skip known portions. Okay, they come for discussion. Here, it's only that the videos are available. I come to the class, I'm available for discussion. Okay, that's the only difference. So these are benefits, because in a synchronous classroom, in a live classroom, where I teach and everybody listens, I have to choose a speed of instruction. So if I choose it for the brightest students, rest of the students get left out. And if I choose it for the bottom-most students, it becomes very boring. Okay? Good students will stop coming to the class. So typically we choose some intermediate speed and make everybody unhappy. Okay? So here what happens is, if you do it in a flipped method, students can learn on their own, at their own speed of interest. If you have this available in more than one language, they can also listen to it in whatever language they choose. So here what happens is, so I had to convince the students, look, this is not too much work. The work that you have to do is exactly same as, so what I did was, three hours of listening to video, 3 hours of listening to video, but come to the class only once a week. Come to the class only once a week. If you have a question, post the questions in discussion forum. Post your questions in discussion forum. So you don't have to come to the class and ask questions. You can post from wherever you are. But I will meet you only once. So now 3 hours of video listening and 1 hour extra, now it is 4 hours as opposed to 3 hours. But it turns out that in a classroom, you speak for 1 hour, you don't really speak for 1 hour. Because you spend 10 minutes, 5 minutes summarizing what you did before. If you give a video, you don't have to give that summary. Cut it out. You want to listen to it? Go and see the previous week's video. Why do you have to summarize? I mean, you can summarize, but not spend 10 minutes on it. Right? And the students save the time coming to the class, going out. And some students, of course, our students say that my classes are very boring because IIT classes are very slow. Okay? So these students tend to see the videos at some X, 1.5X. So they see a lot faster. So they 1 hour video, 45 minute video, which is already a 45 minute video, they finish in half an hour. Okay? So they save on time. And of course they can see it at a convenient time, they can skip portions, they don't like, if they don't understand, listen to it 2-3 times. They can ask questions, they need to worry about only things that they don't understand. Okay? So it was important to convey this message. Okay. I'm going to show you some of the feedback that they gave. So if you see, this paper has, I'll make this paper available to you. Introduction, requirements in the Indian context, that is the second section. Third section was sample and method. Okay. Then instructional method for flipped class. And what is the marking scheme? This is the marking scheme I used. I had a 10 weekly quiz, 10 into 1. And then, so this weekly quiz only tests whether they have gone through the video. They may not have gone through it in detail. So for that, you have to tell them, look, you must go through this. I'm going to ask some problems. So that happens in the big quiz. Okay, 10 marks each. I also had a virtual lab. My single board heater system was available. How many people, by the way, know about virtual labs? Okay, you all know about it. So I made our single board heater system available, and they could access remotely and do this experiment. Basically, they did step tests. They did identified the model. They came up with a PID controller. They implemented, did all kinds of things. Okay, there were two labs, 10 marks. Mid-semester exam, 25 marks. End-semester exam, 25 marks. But these students actually, first time when I did, they came and complained. They said, I didn't know about this flip method, so I've lost marks. Can you give some extra project so that I can make up? So I gave some extra 5 marks. So that's why it became 105, right? This was the marking scheme. So all of you who have who are from autonomous institutions should be able to do this. If you can't do this for the entire course, at least for some portions you can do. Now I'm going to show you student perception. Because student perception is extremely important. Students don't like it, they will not come to the class. Right? Or they will come and they will create trouble. Okay? Or they will go to sleep. So either way, so it is important to take them with you. Right? So the perception was extremely important. I'm going to show some results. We asked this question. The following activities helped you understand the intended topics of this course. Is it weekly quiz, big quiz, mid-semester exam, whatever. You can see that the most popular one was the weekly quiz. It forced them to go through the video, even though the weightage is only 1 mark. Because total weightage was 10, and there are 10 quiz. So weightage per quiz is only 1 mark. Nevertheless, it is 1 mark. So the students go through the video. They come to the class. Okay? Big quiz, mid-semester exam. I didn't have much time to do think, pair, share, so they actually didn't know much about it. Assignment also, our students copy a lot, so I didn't give much weightage. I didn't give, in fact, 0 weightage for assignment. So they think that it is useless, so that is okay. The next one, I asked them, what change is required to make activities more effective? Which one should I increase? Which one should I decrease? Which one should be unchanged? They said weekly quiz, don't change. It's very good, 78%. Okay. Big quiz, no change. These fellows, some people say increase it. Decrease, very few people say that. Okay. Virtual lab, because there was connection problem, and although they say I like hands-on, I don't want to spend too much time. That's the reason why they actually complain. Okay. Okay, I asked that question. Overall, how do you compare the effectiveness? It's a very important question. 61%, 62% of the people said it is more effective than regular class, which is what I was interested in. Comparable, 23%. So if you see, how many people either thought it is as good or better? It's very good. It is 84-85%. Okay, only 15% people thought it was worse than a conventional, which is very good. Then I asked them, those people, for example, these 85% of the people I asked here, how many people found it to be amongst the 85%, this is among the 15%. Okay, this 85%, I asked them, how many people thought more work, equal work, less work compared to the conventional method? Okay, so 41% of the people thought more work, 23% of the people thought equal work, actually 36% of the people thought less work, because they were actually studying then and there, they figured out how to study, they were actually doing it, they thought it was less work. But the other one, people who thought it was worse than conventional method, their answers are interesting. 75% of the people thought that, by the way, they are all low scoring students, it turned out to be that way, most of them. 75% of them thought that it was worse than conventional method, because they said it is, sorry, more work. 75% of the people who thought it was worse than conventional method thought it was more work, so they didn't like it. I think that's what I wanted to say. This is also extremely important. I asked the student, as the instructional team, did I do more work, less work, or equal work? Am I doing it just to save my time? Which is very important, because if they think that you are wasting, you are saving time, you are fooling around, they'll go and complain to the head, complain to the principal, complain to the director, complain to the vice chancellor, this fellow is not teaching. He is having a good time. So 40% of the people thought that we were actually doing more work, because I have to conduct quiz, I have to make the videos first of good quality, I have to create the instructional material, I have to look at the number of 10 quiz, 3 big quiz, and of course our questions are all problems. Problem, 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 problem. Nothing like no description. And we don't repeat questions. So it's a lot of work, setting paper and all that. So same amount of work, 40%, more work, 31%, more work, 41%. Only 27% of the people thought that we were doing less work, which is extremely important. Anytime you want to do something different, you want to take the society with you. You want to take the community with you. You don't want the students to go and complain to your colleagues, to your head, and so on and so forth. Okay. So, and then I think that's all I wanted to say. Here is the attendance. We follow a 10-point scale for grading. A is 10, AB is 9, and so on. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. Below 4 is fail. And it turns out that if you look at the students who had got the highest grade, they had attended 95% of the weekly quiz. So there is a more or less monotonic decrease. Here, small blip is there. This shows coming to weekly quiz is not good enough. You have to actually study more. Okay, they might have come to the class, but this is only attendance. And these are average marks they scored. Okay, we have done a lot of statistics. We found that those people who scored high marks in weekly quiz got high marks in big quiz, got high marks in mid-semester exam, also got high marks in end-semester exam. That was important for me to tell because I had to tell, if somebody asks, on what basis are you not teaching in the class? Okay, because I'm supposed to teach, students are supposed to understand. How do you know that they are understanding? So the answer is, look, they are going through the videos, so they are doing well in weekly quiz. The same students are doing well in, there is a correlation between that and big quiz scores, mid-semester score, end semester score, and overall grades. So this shows that they are studying. So what is the objective of a contact class? That you have to teach them something, and they are learning anyway. So it's okay if you don't teach in the class, you using conventional methods. So we need to build all these things. You know, it is not that somebody is going to tell, MIT they are using it, so I'm going to use it. That's not enough. Because what MIT does may not be applicable to us. So it is our responsibility to make sure, to convince whatever step is required, we must take to convince our administration. It's not going to happen just because somebody else, just because IIT Bombay says, just because Professor Fatak says, flip class is good, take it, your college administration will not accept it. You have to convince them. Like I have done. This is the second time I did this flip class. Second time I did this, published this report. Third time I did, that time there was actually a faculty shortage. So I said, the biggest benefit of flipped classroom is number of students can be any number. It can be 1,000 students. Because I'm not teaching anything. Learning happens one-on-one from a computer screen, which is right next to me. So all students are learning. So flipped method is very good. It's very important for our country, because a good teacher can make available his or her teaching to thousands of students. That is why we want to promote it, not to save that time. Of course, they will have to work hard, they will have to prepare very nice instructional material. But in the long run, just imagine if each college creates just one good course. One course means one paper, right? 40 lectures. Each college just creates just one. And there are 35,000 colleges in India. If each one gives the best, then it's a great collection that we will have. So it's a lot of work, right? But then it can be used by many people. It can be used by many people. That is the reason why I wanted to use clip method. So I didn't want to say that MIT is doing it, let me use it. In fact, I found that what MIT is doing, it may not work here. Because the Western audience, students, pay a lot of money for their course, for their education. And they will come to every class and they will ask questions. I paid, you better answer my question. Here our students want to take leave. They don't want to come to the class because their parents pay or it is not paid. I'm not saying that we should start charging them in big amount. I'm not saying that. All that I'm saying is that method may not work here. We need to come up with suitable method for our children, for your college, for your state, your university. It could be different. You'll have to modify it. But it is important to do that. Okay? So that's a message I wanted to convey here.
Sir, I have one question.
Yeah.
Whatever the question mentioned in this paper is asked by the students studying in the IITs. There are students, they are studying in some other remote places. How we can decide that the perception of students, those who are studying in the IITs, are same as the studying in the remote places?
Good question. You'll have to find out. You'll have to find out. That's what I'm saying. That's precisely what I said. That's precisely what I said. Just because MIT says, I can't use it. In fact, I found that what MIT is using cannot be used directly. Right?
Yeah.
Because they say every day you should have a class, should have discussion. Or people don't want to come, or they will come to the class without reading. So MIT's method will not work. I wanted to have the essence of flip method to be available, that anytime, any place, any amount of reading, skipping known portions, spending a lot more time on difficult portions. We do have students who are weak in English. They listen to the video 2-3 times. Imagine their plight in the class. You're speaking at some speed, and by the time this fellow understands, you've gone past. That person can listen to it 2-3 times. So MIT doesn't have that problem. So what I'm saying is, this is a method you have to tweak. You cannot say that IIT is saying it, so I want to use it. You cannot, you should not say that. Your administration will ask precisely the same question to you. Just because IIT is using it, how do you know it will work for our students? You have to do experiments. That's precisely what I'm saying.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
1 hour.
How many hours? They come to the class only once. They come to the class only once. Only 1 hour. They go through the video, 3 hours worth of video. They also ask questions in a forum. By the way, I also found that our students do not like to ask questions because they'll get bashed up by their classmates. Why are you asking questions? Why are you learning? Why are you spending so much time? So, after some time, I found out, in the beginning, I used to use Moodle and I used to give marks. 10 marks for questions posted. Then I would say that for every class, this is the cutoff date. Just 5 minutes before, you will get 100 questions. Okay? Because they were more interested in getting the marks rather than asking questions. So, but it is not that our students don't want to ask questions. There are students who want to ask questions, but they don't want to get bashed up. So, it is important to use an anonymous facility. That anonymous facility is not available in Moodle. So, as a result, I went to Piazza. Piazza, P-I-A-Z-Z-A, Piazza. Piazza is a discussion forum. Piazza, see the last line? Piazza is a discussion forum that's only for discussions, so you can use that. And that gives an option to post any question anonymously. So there is a question, I don't have to know. I don't have to know who's asking that question. Of course, I find out. Soon enough, I come to the class, the same student comes to the class, at the end of the class, asks me the same question. So I know. Okay? There are only a few questions who ask, but they ask the difficult questions. So fine. Some questions, some concepts that are not clear. And you see, in fact, let me show you that. Now I am using something called a Bodhi tree. It is created by my colleague here at IIT Bombay called Kameswari. So this is where I had posted. So these are weekly based. So first week, introduction to course organization, introduction to modeling strategies, Laplace transform, transfer function model, root locus, okay, then PID tuning, then frequency response, body plots, Nyquist plot, the dynamic matrix control, Z transform. Today I finished, I mean, I conducted the quiz on Z transform. If I click this, so that class was divided into three portions. So there are three videos in this. Each one maybe 10 minutes, 15 minutes. So I already created. In fact, when I created, when I was giving the 1 hour class, some of my students had started a company, startup, and they were running MOOCs, okay, on their own platform. They asked me whether I would make available my videos, because I was also going to record, to them so that they could run their MOOCs platform. Only thing is, they said, can you please, in every class, can you say that, you know, there are some chunks? So as a result, what I started doing was, when I went to the class, I would say, today I'm going to teach three topics. Okay? So finish the first topic, conduct a clicker question. Okay, now I'm going to the second topic. So each one is divided and it can be cut there. Okay? So it came out of 1 hour class, but it required a little bit of planning. Otherwise, people start asking, how can I teach anything for 10 minutes? How can I complete a topic in 10 minutes? How can I complete a topic in 15 minutes? Of course you can do that. It requires a little bit of planning. But if you do that, because people have found that the ideal time of concentration is about 9 minutes. If you ask a student to listen to any video more than some 10 minutes long, 15 minutes long, their attention span comes down. And if it is very long, then they just actually don't see it. So this is how I created this. So if you look at this, motivating Z transform. So this one has video. This is the video. Okay. So the video they can listen to. But I wanted to show you the discussion. Let me go to the discussion. So there are 110 threads. Okay, of course some are on virtual lab, they are saying something is not working and so on. Okay, because this is lab submission date, a lot of people are asking questions. But if I go down, there it is. Doubt regarding rise time. So here is a question. Is the rise time defined as, and who has posted it? You can see it here, it is anonymous. All questions are anonymous. They ask questions, right? So that many of these things will be applicable to you. So you don't have to waste time. Go to Piazza, start using it. If you decide to do 3 hours, don't engage the students 3 hours. Then they will say it is too much work, I'll come to the class without reading. That also will not work. Okay? Okay, any other question? Yeah.
How did you conduct the two types of quizzes?
The first one was just a paper. They're all paper based. First paper was multiple choice. It takes only 15 minutes every week. But bigger one was problem solving. So derive this, or draw the root locus, find the regions of stability. Okay, here is a plant, here is a controller, whatever it is, design a controller. It could even be descriptive. You can say, describe this. Right? One could ask that.
So the paper quiz means you hand corrected all the answers yourself?
Yeah, I had TAs. I asked them to upgrade it. We tried to use something called Safe App. It was also created by my colleague, Bhaskar Raman. It uses mobile phones. It uses mobile phones. And basically what that app does is it takes control of the phone. And then so that they cannot connect to internet and so on, right? And it's very similar to our plickers, except that the answer is to be given by students on their mobile phone. So we had some technology related problems as a result, and I didn't want to enforce that everybody should use mobile phone, because there were, of course, we had enough Akash tablets we could have given, but for various reasons I allowed people to write on paper also. So there will be two sections, half the class will be answering on the mobile phone, other half will be answering on the paper. After a while, our TA said that it was too much work, that we have to handle this, we have to enter all the questions in a particular form. It didn't make sense. They said, make them all either phone-based or all paper-based. Both are okay. So I said paper-based, because I didn't want to enforce too much of experimentation. But it could have been done that way. But big quiz has to be written, have to derive it. There is no software, no nothing. We'll do that. So other things that I wanted to talk about was, one was spoken tutorials. Some people wanted to say some good things about spoken tutorials. Anybody here?
I am Anand Murthy from SJ College of Engineering. I think you will remember me. So I have contributed one spoken tutorial on NGSpice.
Yeah.
My students are also using many of the tutorials available there. We have conducted workshops on Python, LaTeX, and Scilab. And students have found it very useful.
Thank you. So we actually have trained 33 lakh students till now. And if you see here, in this month alone, we have trained close to 7 lakh students, this year alone. And we are only in March. We are almost adding 10,000 students are joining every month. 10,000 students are joining every month. So we expect to do about, going by this rate, about 25 lakh students to be trained this year. 25 lakh means what? Somebody does a training on C programming, then that is considered as one. And nowadays we are doing a mapping so that they can do it as a part of the lab. So this is something I wanted to talk about. I wanted to talk about the work on Scilab. I don't know how many people know about this. We have cloud.scilab.in. In this, what we have is something called Textbook Companion. Okay? Many of you may not have seen this. It's very useful. It's called cloud.scilab.in. Now, let me show you how this is used. So for example, I'm teaching control theory, control systems, and there are a lot of books in that topic. So supposing I select this BC Co, which is a standard book, and then I say that, let's say, frequency domain analysis. So this is the 9th chapter of the standard book, let's say Bode plot. The moment I select for that example 9.15 in this book, the Scilab code is available, right? In fact, we have Scilab code available for all solved examples of this book. That is called a textbook companion. We have this for 550 textbooks. That means it is available for communication, signal processing, civil engineering, fluid mechanics, chemistry, physics, maths, and so on and so forth. So now this is available, I execute. Of course, to execute this, you need internet. It goes to Garuda Cloud in Bangalore. So here it is. Here is the Bode plot, right? The result of that. And not only that, I can come and say, look, if I used If the transfer function is this, then the gain margin, phase margin are this. What will happen if I change this number to, supposing I increase the gain to twice the amount? Instead of 2500, I made it 5000. That means this window is editable. You can actually go and change the numbers, you can execute. So which means that if a student is going through a problem, or you are explaining a solved problem, you want to redo this for some other thing, this is already available. Okay, and this is available. So now, see this, now it is 5000, and the margins also have become smaller. So this is something I wanted to talk about. This is also available for offline use, scilab.in. By the way, who created all these textbook companions? They're all students from your colleges. We have about 1,000 students across the country who have contributed this. So here it is, textbook companion project, completed books. So if you see here, there are 551. So it's all in all these topics, fluid mechanics, all these books, control theory, chemical engineering, thermodynamics, mechanical engineering, various topics. I mean, our classification is not the greatest, right? So this is something that I wanted to talk about. The other thing that I wanted to talk about is lab migration. So here it is. So you have a lab that is happening, and then you say that I want to shift from MATLAB to Scilab. Can you help? So the answer is here, yes. In fact, I'll show you the completed labs. How many people have migrated their labs from MATLAB to Scilab? These are all the different people from various colleges across the country. There are 59 people. So let's say what Haldia Institute of Technology, Digital Signal Processing, what they have done. If I click that, so it gives the information. I can even download the, who did this? Professor Teertha Deep Sinha, DSP, Electronics Engineering, Haldia Institute of Technology. I can even see the PDF of lab solutions. Let me save this. Let me open this. So here is the PDF of, you can say, convolution of two sequences using graphical methods and using commands. Let me click that. It immediately takes me there. It gives the solution, so on and so forth. So lab migration you may find very useful. We are also doing toolboxes. We have identified 6 or 7 toolboxes to be very popular. Our optimization toolbox, Scilab optimization toolbox, is better than MATLAB optimization toolbox. As a matter of fact, we wrote a paper on that, how we went about creating this. So optimization, signal processing, image processing, communications, computer vision, Scilab 2C. So there are many toolboxes. I believe that it will cover the needs of many people. So this is another thing that I'm running out of time. Then eSIM is another thing that we are working on. eSIM is an alternative to ORCAD, PSPICE, completely open source, and it's available here. In fact, if you go to FOSSI.in, you will have all this information. So FOSSI is the other project we run. So you can see that projects are Scilab, all the Scilab work is here. Python, eSIM, if you click, it will immediately open this about eSIM. Here is, you know, how to download, how many people have seen it, the whole thing is available. How many people are interested in solving differential equations as a part of your modeling? So if so, then there is a great software called Open Modelica, we promote. It's here. Open Modelica, all the things we do here. DWSim is for chemical process simulation. Open Foam is for is an alternative to computational fluid dynamics. If your college, mechanical engineering college, wants to offer a course in computational fluid dynamics, Open Foam is available. OSDAG is for civil engineers, design, Python, all that we do is here. Then Sandhi is an alternative to LabVIEW. And of course, we have some open source hardware projects also. Okay. So I'm going to stop here. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Sir. Yeah. It may be my limitation, but I have never found a rigorous analysis or methodical analysis for teachers' understanding and teachers' pleasure level in teaching process. Yeah. Like the student satisfaction level we very frequently take as a feedback for improvement, we most of the cases teachers take it granted that our method is only for students. But on the reverse, if we think, sir, when I search papers, when I search research work from Indian context, there is a very geographical variation, method variation, and even infrastructure variation. In that case, teachers have not scope to think about themselves, how they can enter in a class, and there is a variety, large spectrum of students whom we really face. Particularly in our entrance system, we get from all part of the India students in one class. Even language understanding is a very tough problem. From a teacher's concept and teacher's perspective, sir, if you can guide us, is there any kind of way which has already been done, or is there any other thinking method where students, in one way, they are research part, but how the teacher can involve themselves in some kind of research component? That's all.
So actually, it's a good question, but a difficult question, because if it can be, these are the steps that one should follow to be a good teacher, right? Maybe that can even be automated. And often people say that because of all these methods, we are going to make teachers' job redundant, right? The answer is, you can't do that. In other words, your question is a difficult one, I cannot answer. If it is something that I can answer easily, then teachers' jobs will vanish, right? So we need people, we need to figure out how to do this. It's a continuing process. I agree with you.
Sir, from the year 2013 onwards, the impact of MOOCs over students as well as the teaching fraternity is gradually increasing. More and more people are started employing this kind of technology in universities and colleges and all.
Right.
So as a visionary, in fact, you are into this domain for the past 4 or 5 years. What do you think the role of a teacher will be in another 3 or 4 years down the line? Because it's more kind of a disruptive technology. This is and definitely more and more people are going to get... they're going to suffer, in fact, in the long run teaching fraternity, because if they are going to not going to raise their level up to few notches, definitely these jobs are going to be a problem for the teachers. So what do you think teachers know they can do to equip themselves to face this kind of situation?
Yeah. In fact, I feel the opposite. In fact, I feel the opposite because there are very few people who can claim to be brilliant teachers. Very few people. It's very small percentage. 0.1%, 1%, 0.1%. Okay? What about other people? Can other people become better teachers? It turns out that some of these methods are very useful to become better teachers. Right? So I believe that we will become better teachers. Our students will learn better. Of course, only thing is we should not be too rigid. If they say that I will learn only from a mobile phone, let them learn. We should not have fixed opinion. I believe that many of these tools will allow us, because if you look at our gross enrollment ratio, is only some 20-25%. Okay, and of course, we are aiming for 30%. And our learning levels are very low. Especially if you look at, what is happening in states like UP, how they are, and people are actually thinking about what is it we should do so that, people actually start learning. How do we bring back learning? How do we bring learning back to classrooms? This is something that people are talking about, which means people are actually talking about improving teaching. So that's why I started with saying very few people are brilliant. Okay, but using these methods, even an average teacher can make their instruction level very good. Find out then and there, are they following, not following, do hand-holding, identify good instructional material, ask them to learn, conduct a quiz, you can do all kinds of things. right? So I, in fact, feel the other way, that it is going to help us become better country. Our educational system will become better with time. Okay, of course, we all have to work. We all have to be interested. And of course, because you are interested, you all come. The fact that we have such a large audience here and staying till 6 o'clock shows that, you know, we are all interested. I'm sure that it will improve. So I feel the opposite. Yeah.
So this laptop, I thought I would just show this to you. This is, of course, I mean, we came up with Akash first. Then we came up with a laptop, low-cost laptop, ARM processor based. This is not really low-end, but I mean, that inexpensive. This is a base model available at 15,000 rupees. This is Acer. Acer laptop, Celeron. It comes with half a terabyte hard disk, 2 GB RAM. What I did was, I put an additional 4 GB RAM. So this has 6 GB RAM, half a terabyte hard disk, and it is 19,000 rupees. So this is, I believe it's actually a very nice machine. It weighs only about 1 kg. So this is another thing that I wanted to share, but I ran out of time, I forgot. So,
okay. So if there are no questions, I will take your leave. Thanks for listening to me. Yeah.